peace to you from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Welcome to our worship service this morning, this second Sunday of Advent. And while it is the second Sunday of Advent, it is the first Sunday of the month. So we will be celebrating the Lord's Supper, and I encourage you to get something to be the elements, to be the body and blood of Christ. A cracker, a piece of bread, something to drink, whatever you have, gather that up and we will partake later in the service for the Lord's Supper. Thank you so much for your patience. First, we had a hard time going live, and once we went live, you discovered before we did, that we did not have sound. So we've just got an iPhone going this morning. I hope you can hear us and sort of see us this morning. So thank you for your patience. And let's just all take a deep breath as we prepare to worship God. A breath in and a breath out. Let us worship God.
Let us read the call to worship, Isaiah 9, verses 6 and 7. For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder. These will be his royal titles: Wonderful, Counselor, the Mighty God, the Everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace. His ever-expanding, peaceful government will never end. He will rule with perfect fairness and justice from the throne of his father David. He will bring true justice and peace to all the nations of the world. This is going to happen because the Lord of heaven has dedicated himself to do it.
Oh, come, let us adore him. Oh, come, let us adore him. Oh, come, let us adore him. Christ the Lord.
Holy Lord, in this time of Advent, we confess we often are distracted by the season's busyness, by the stress of commitment, and even by putting our own traditions ahead of the true meaning of Christmas. We confess we also often prefer being sentimental to being sacrificial. Forgive us for all the times we have missed seeing you in our midst, for all the times we have doubted your presence, and for all the times we have failed to hold the holidays as holy days. Pour peace into our lives, and let us be bearers of your peace to others. Remind us that this is a season of waiting and preparation for the greatest gift of all. In the holy name of our Savior, Jesus, we pray. Amen. Now, this is true love. Not our love for God, but God's love for us. Even now, God approaches us. Mercy transcending anger. Hope overcoming despair. Life triumphing over death. This is good news, my friends. This is news of great joy for each of us. In Christ, we are a forgiven and redeemed people. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Thank you. Everybody loves a knock-knock joke. So, let's start with one. Knock-knock.
Who's there?
Who's there?
Mary.
Mary who?
Merry Christmas!
Ah!
I think we need the canned laughter for this. No one. Knock-knock.
Who's there?
Holly.
Holly who?
Holidays are on us!
Oh.
So, remember, during this time of year, there was also a knock-knock at Mary's door, and it was an angel. And when Mary kind of figured out it was an angel, the angel gave her a message. So the message was that God was going to give her a child, and that child was going to be who we know to be Jesus. Now, if somebody shows up at your door and does a little knock-knock at your door, and you open it, and it's somebody that you don't know, it's kind of like a stranger. So, I don't know, you know, we're told a long time ago that, you know, maybe we don't, you know, look at strangers as nicely as we look at other people that we know. But Mary had a good feeling about this stranger. And he brought a message from God. So, you know, Mary kind of believed what was going on, and after a little bit of convincing, Mary said, okay, I'll do what God is asking you to do. So what we find sometimes, and what I find sometimes, is God does knock-knocks to me. God knock-knocks on my heart. God knock-knocks on my soul. Sometimes God knock-knocks on my brain. I see something. I hear something. I watch something, and it speaks to me. And a lot of times, like with an angel, God speaks to me through different people, different places, different things. So during this time of season, if you get a knock-knock from God, remember, knock-knock, who's there? God. God who? God who wants us to be kind. God who wants us to be generous. And most of all, God who wants us to be loving. So there was an old program back in the day called Romper Room. I don't know if anybody grew up watching Romper Room, but you know, had Misty. Well, you know, I know there's some kids out there today, and I hope they're out there listening, because I'm going to do a couple more knock knocks to get us out of here. Knock knock.
Who's there?
Clara.
Clara.
Clarify that God wants you to be good. Oh, knock knock.
Who's there?
Whit.
Whit-hoo.
When you're with God, you're never alone. We're going to end this with our Father. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, power, and glory forever. Amen. Advent. our hearts and homes to receive Jesus Christ. God is about to be among us.
Left her. The word of God for the people of God. such a heavenly visit. She was unsuitable in the eyes of her people to be used mightily of God. But God saw Mary's trust and obedience. He knew she would be willing to serve him in one of the most important callings ever given to a human being. God will often use the most unlikely candidates to serve him. We see even before Jesus' birth that Jesus wants to be a part of all lives. The important, the lowly, the rich, the poor, the men, the young girls. And as we prepare our hearts for the arrival of the Messiah, we also find a peculiar truth. Almost every other religion in the world is structured so that humans have to make their way, they have to work their way to the God or the higher power, to a better life. But in this upside down, backwards kingdom of Jesus, God comes to us in a lowly born babe. In Hinduism, a person is on their own, working and trying to gain release from karma. In New Age, a person is working at their own divinity. In Buddhism, an individual quest, it is an individual quest to be free from desire. And in Islam, the individual follows religious laws for the sake of paradise after death. With Jesus Christ, we see God offering us a relationship in the here and now with himself, not based on our efforts, but based on what God does for us. The incarnation, the word means in the flesh. God, the divine, takes on humanity in the flesh and comes to us. At this stunning moment in history, God's plan for redeeming his people is revealed, and no one could have guessed he would have done it in such a way. He would set out to save mankind, humanity, from the inside. God would become one of us. This thought is so scandalous and would be sacrilegious if it were not true. But it is true. The Son of the Most High God will be born of the humble Mary. Our God is not a far-off deity who demands that we make our way to him. God comes to us. God is near. God is among us. Well, back to Mary and Zechariah. They both ask similar questions after Gabriel greets them, but they have very different heart attitudes. Remember last week, Zechariah asks, "How can I be sure of this? My wife is very old." Zechariah wants to be in control. He wants proof that this is going to happen. Mary asks, "How will this happen?" Mary believes it will happen. She just doesn't understand how it will happen. Zechariah loses his voice and is not able to talk for 9 months as he waits in the silence. Mary offers her obedience. She offers her whole self. Remember the Hebrew word, Hanani? Here I am. pregnant before her wedding day. According to the law, she could be executed for becoming pregnant by anyone but Joseph, whom she was engaged to. She could at least be punished in a severe and humiliating way. Mary still agrees, knowing it will not be easy. She accepts the angel's offer, and even if she is fearful, rightfully so, she does not fall into the trap of stressing out and refusing joy. Refusing joy. What a great phrase. We are so stressed out by trying to live right, eat right, think right, act right, speak right, parent right, exercise right, look right, do Christmas right. Have we forgotten the joy of Jesus? Think of the many solid reasons that Mary could give for saying no to the angel Gabriel. It's not the right time. Not the right place. Not the right partner. Not the right family system. Not the right plan for the future. And yet she says, "Here I am. Let it be." In spite of all the seemingly solid reasons to say no, she doesn't want to be guilty of refusing the joy. "Restore unto me the joy of thy salvation." And Mary indeed will sing to the Lord. We'll get that scripture next Sunday. So Zechariah wanted proof. Ironically, Mary actually gets some proof. The angel Gabriel tells her that her cousin Elizabeth, who was unable to conceive, is now 6 months pregnant. And then the angel says, "Nothing is impossible with God." Zechariah was told by the angel Gabriel that his son would be named John, not the family name, and that he would prepare the way for the Messiah. Mary was told that her son would be named Jesus, from the Hebrew Joshua or Yeshua, meaning Yahweh, the Lord, saves. Gabriel also said that Jesus would be great and would be called the Son of the Most High and God's Son. Jesus. The incarnation of the divine, God in the flesh, Yahweh saves. This Jesus is coming to us. God doing for us what we cannot do for ourselves. We cannot keep the law perfectly. We cannot earn our way to God. And amazingly, that is not what God requires. You see, God loves us. And Scripture tells us that perfect love casts out fear. Do not be afraid. It is written 365 times in Scripture. Do not be afraid. In Romans, the Apostle Paul speaks to how the law cannot save us. We can't work our way to God. This is from the Message. Paul says, "But I need something more, for if I know the law but still can't keep it, and if the power of sin within me keeps sabotaging my best intentions, I obviously need help. I realize I don't have what it takes. I can will it, but I can't do it. I decide to do good, but I don't really do it. I decide not to do bad, but then I do actions, something has gone wrong deep within me and gets the better of me every time. It happens so regularly that it's predictable. The moment I decide to do good, sin is there to trip me up. I truly delight in God's commands, but it's pretty obvious that not all of me joins in that delight. Parts of me covertly rebel, and just when I least expect it, they take charge. I've tried everything, and nothing helps. I'm at the end of my rope. Is there no one who can do anything for me? Isn't that the real question? The answer, thank God, is that Jesus Christ can and does. He acted to set things right in his life of contradictions, this life of contradictions, where I want to serve God with all my heart and mind, but I am pulled by the influence of sin to do something totally different. With the arrival of Jesus, the Messiah, that fateful dilemma is resolved. Those who enter into Christ's being here for us no longer have to live under a continuous, low-lying black cloud. A new power is in operation. The spirit of life in Christ, like a strong wind, has magnificently cleared the air, freeing you from a faded lifetime of brutal tyranny at the hands of sin and death. The NRV says it this way: there is therefore no condemnation for those in Christ Jesus. Jesus, Yahweh, saves. God comes to us. We don't have to work our way to him. We don't earn salvation. Friends, it is a gift. A gift from God. Thanks be to God. Richard Rohr says, we all need to know that God does not love us because we are good. God loves us because God is good. Nothing humans can do will ever decrease or increase God's eternal eagerness to love. Jesus did not come to change the mind of God about humanity. It didn't need changing. Jesus came to change the mind of humanity about God. Today, on this second Sunday in Advent, as we continue our waiting of the coming of the Christ child, we remember how deep God's love is for us. We should be called God's children. We are sons and daughters of God. We remember that 33 or so years after the miraculous incarnation, that Jesus willingly gave up his life for ours. So today, whether you are more like Zechariah, wanting proof and wanting to be in control, or more like Mary, singing God's praises and offering your whole life wholeheartedly to serve the Lord, today, as we take the bread and the wine, let us remember the incarnation, God coming to us in the flesh, God offering his life, giving his life, that we may have life and have it abundantly. Joy to the world. Joy. Joy. Thanks be to God. Amen. Friends, this is the Lord's table. It is Jesus himself, God incarnate, who invites all to come, all to take their place at his table. Into the silence, God speaks. God fills the hungry with good things and feeds his children at this table. Gather now as one to receive God's body, Jesus' body and blood, assured of God's forgiveness and joyful in the anticipation of Jesus coming among us. Let us pray. Lord, it is right to give you our thanks and praise. You break forth with the light and bring the new creation. Though we chose to embrace the darkness of sin, still you come to us with good news of your love. When we forget the good way of your truth, you remember us and look upon us with favor. Therefore, with Mary and Elizabeth and all the other hosts of heaven, we stand in awe before you to join their chorus of praise. Blessed be you, Lord Jesus Christ, born among strangers, out among the animals in Bethlehem. You taught us God's way of grace as you lived it to the edge of death, where you gave yourself for us as the bread of life eternal. Rising from the grave with the dawn of your eternal kingdom, you invite us to live in accord with your sovereign way. We give you thanks, O Holy Spirit, for making life pregnant with possibility. Come now to overshadow us with your power, that in the breaking of this bread and in the drinking of this cup, we may recognize your presence with the joyful, yes, here I am. As your servants, we bring before you the needs of a hurting world and ask that you remember your creation, even as we remember you. We pray for the world of nations, including our own, as we continue to grapple with a relentless pandemic. We pray especially for the vulnerable among us, the medical professionals and staff, for essential workers, for parents with school-aged children, for the elderly, and for those with pre-existing health conditions. Oh God, help us to live responsibly in ways that protect the well-being of others. We pray for all who are grieving the loss of loved ones during these difficult days. We pray that you would grant wisdom to the leadership of our local communities, our cities, our states, and our country, that they might discern a path forward in these perilous times. Indeed, grant all of us wisdom and courage for the living of these days. Keep us, your church, in communion with you and one another and the world you so love, until we feast with you and all the saints in glory. These our prayers, our lives, we offer through you, with you, in you, in the unity of the Holy Spirit. May all blessing and honor and dominion be yours, O God, now and forevermore. Amen. Friends, on the night in which he was betrayed, Jesus took the bread. He blessed it, giving thanks to God, and he broke it, and he gave gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you." In the same manner also, after supper, he took the cup, and after giving thanks, said, "This cup is the new covenant sealed in my blood, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim Christ's saving death and resurrection until he comes again." Brothers and sisters, the gifts of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Amen. You may partake while Kelly sings "For Everyone Born." Thank you, Lord, that you come to us in the ordinary stuff of this world, bread, juice, crackers, whatever we have, to nurture us with your presence. Now may we live in unity, watching for your coming among us, that we may praise you in all we do, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Friends, as you await the coming of the Christ child, the incarnation of Yahweh saves, Jesus, may we prepare our hearts. Let every heart prepare him room. May we be ready. Keep your lamps trimmed and burning, for there is a great joy a coming. Amen.